वेलकम बैक। प्रीवियसली वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द कोऑपरेटिव मूवमेंट एंड कोऑपरेटिव सिस्टम दैट वाज ऑपरेटिंग इन डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द कंट्रीज इन अफ्रीका। लेट अस डिस्कस अबाउट द फर्दर केसेस दैट कम्स अंडर द सेम कैटेगरी। प्रीवियसली वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट डोनर पॉलिसी एंड वी हैव डेल्ट द वेरियस एस्पेक्ट विद रिगार्ड टू दैट। नेक्स्ट वन, नॉन गवर्नमेंटल प्रमोशनल ऑर्गनाइजेशंस। So what is the meaning of non-governmental and promotional organization? These are organizations that are implemented or formulated with the objective of promoting the cooperative movements in different parts of the countries in Africa. So how does it operate? The specialized cooperative development NGOs, otherwise known as non-governmental organizations, formed by the cooperative movements of industrialized countries are active in Africa and they apply movement to movement approach to one another. So movement to movement approach means it means transferring of expertise, technology, techniques, methods, assistance from one cooperative movement to the another. That is the meaning of movement to movement approach. So NGOs always encourage movement to movement approach with regard to cooperative movement, so that one cooperative movement provides these facilities to another cooperative movement that are under requirement. So the cooperative centers of various countries such as Denmark, Finland, Sweden, Netherlands, Germany, Belgium, etc. are some of the examples where this moment-to-moment approach was implemented. And try to identify what are the various cooperative centers with regard to all these different countries. There will be a cooperative center for Denmark, there will be a center for our cooperative movement in Sweden, and there will be in Germany. So try to identify the cooperative centers or movement in these foreign countries where this movement to movement approach was encouraged. Try to identify that. And movement to movement approach was successful in the development of credit unions and self-housing schemes. Credit unions means concerned that are or cooperative movements dealing credit cooperative movements or cooperatives that are mainly concentrated on credit related activities. And self-housing schemes means self-housing cooperative movements likewise. And this approach was more successful in credit unions and self-housing schemes rather than in the field of agricultural marketing and supply cooperatives. Majority of local, national, international NGOs in Africa effectively promote cooperative like groups and associations, because only through these groups and associations and through mutual help between these groups and associations, the cooperative movement can survive and flourish in African countries. That is why local, national and international NGOs were effectively promoting cooperative groups and associations. So whenever a group is required an assistance, subsequent other fellow groups or associations can help through this movement-to-movement approach. So even after all these, there are still some issues with regard to these promotional activities, because some of the issues with regard to non-governmental promotional organizations are lack of expertise to develop the appropriate managing system and train groups leaders accordingly. Even after all these promotional activities, they still lack the expertise knowledge to develop appropriate managing system and train group leaders. So only through a proper managing system that can be implemented in a cooperative system and a training group leaders, only through, because usually a cooperative movement or a cooperative scheme will be run under a leader. So training of leaders is of great importance, but all these activities still it lack expertise to provide managing system as well as training of leaders. And another issue with regard to the cooperative movement that was working in African system was that Many of the NGOs discourage national cooperative movement so as to support their own groups and move away from competitors. The cooperative movements implemented in different parts of the country, usually, even though they are working for the members or the common people, their ultimate motto will be to support either the ruling party or the ethnic groups that are supporting those cooperative movements. Anyway, those cooperatives were having partiality to a person or a group or other one way or the other. So partiality will not lead to development of cooperative movement. So that was another issue with regard to NGOs. And always they try to move away from competitors. By facing the competition, only a cooperative movement can survive. They always try to support their own groups, at the same time they move away from competitors. That is an issue with regard to national non-governmental promotional organizations. Next one, how credit cooperatives operate. So we have known that there are different types of cooperative movement: credit cooperatives, agriculture cooperatives, fisheries cooperatives, self-housing cooperatives. There are a number of cooperatives. So how a credit cooperative operate? Usually credit cooperatives operate in a bi-fold system, because the purpose of loans for the cooperative is mainly bi-fold. They finance their own operations and at the same time granting short-term loans to their members. That were the two major activities done by a credit cooperative societies. So we know that the main practice of an agricultural cooperative is to obtain loan from parastatal development banks and without any collateral security. Parastatal means usually it is a government-owned or government-sponsored banks. Agricultural cooperatives usually obtain loan from parastatal development banks without any collateral security, and they seldom repay. One of the main reasons for the agricultural cooperative to face failure in Africa is this one, because they get abundant funds and finance from government banks or government sponsored facilities, and they get loans without any collateral securities. Without any sort of security, they will easily get huge amounts of funds, and at the same time they are not forced to repay the loans on time. That is an issue with regard to agricultural cooperatives, and that were one of the reasons that led to the failure of agricultural cooperatives in different parts of the Africa. So the non-repayment seldom entailed any actions, and thus cooperatives accumulated huge amounts of funds and never diminishing arrears. They will not be paying back any sort of interest or repay back loans, and here there will be huge arrears. Because of this, now at present, cooperatives must obtain loan from commercial banks at marketing conditions, because of the implementation of SAPs. We have learned about SAPs in the previous session, so the meaning of SAPs. By introduction of SAPs, now the cooperatives, mainly agricultural cooperatives or any other cooperative, has to obtain loan from commercial banks. We all know the concept of commercial banks. They will not be lenient like a government banks. They will just like a commercial banks providing loans, but they will ask for proper collateral security, and whoever is taking loan, they have to repay the loans on time. And usually these loans will be provided in market rate. So the cooperatives has to suffer with regard to non-repayment of loans. Because of this, stringent loan conditions has led to many of the state-sponsored cooperatives, their actions has been declined. Stringent loan means strict loan practices. We all know that commercial banks offer, even though they offer good credit facilities, they follow a strict loan procedure. Interest will be high, or interest will be the market condition same, and you need to repay on time. So stringent loan conditions discourage many state sponsored cooperatives, because the earlier state sponsored cooperatives were acquiring huge amounts from government, state government banks or parastatal banks likewise, and then you don't have to repay on time. Now they have to repay. So that is a present issue or present situation with regards to credit acquirement by cooperative sections. And at the same time, small farmers got their loans from agricultural marketing and supply cooperatives. They distribute loans received from development banks to their members, and in turn they take repayment on behalf of those banks. And at the same time, in certain eastern and southern African countries, usually in southern African countries, but also in some eastern African countries, specialized cooperative banks are established to cater or to provide financial needs of the cooperatives. At the same time, they became successful only when their doors were open for the general public. These specialized cooperative banks will provide financial assistance to the cooperative movements, unlike the methods they have been following in the previous session. Previously, they were getting loans without any collateral security and they did not have to pay any loans. But these specialized cooperative banks provide financial assistance only on the basis of collateral security, and they have to repay on time. In some other African countries, savings and credit cooperatives mobilize funds for other cooperatives, but at the same time they prefer to invest their excess liquidity in government bonds and other secured financial instruments, as cooperatives do not offer sufficient loan guarantees. As I have mentioned earlier, investing this excess amount in a cooperative sector is a risky aspect, because they will not get any returns at a market value, or whatever the profitability that can be acquired from that investment will not be expected from a cooperative sector. So usually savings and credit cooperatives invest their funds in government bonds. Government bonds means, just like the government bonds in our country also, they are secure, the returns are safe, likewise. So instead of providing funds or loan assistance to cooperative movements, savings and credit cooperatives offer invest their liquid cash in government bonds because of the situations prevailing in the African countries. That was the reason. Because providing credit to a cooperative movements is a risky aspect. So that was the credit operation activities in African countries. Next one, vertical and horizontal integration. In the beginning of this session, we have mentioned the term vertical integration system or vertical structure and horizontal structure. It's almost similar. There is a slight difference between vertical and horizontal, as the name suggests. So before we go further into that, first of all, identify what is the meaning of the structure. Let us begin with vertical integration. The cooperatives have a tendency to create vertical structures, and such structures are common in English and French colonial countries. In Africa, we know that there are many countries that were under the rule of English or Britain or under the rule of French. So usually this vertical integration system was common in English speaking and French speaking African countries. So how does it operate? This is the basic structure of a vertical integration system. At the top level, there will be an apex unit, otherwise known as a national federation. Under that, there will be different subsidiaries depending upon the specialization in which it operates. In this case, it is a subsidiary company, usually in case of audit concerns, or in case subsidiary companies that are dealing with export activities. Under these subsidiaries, there will be sectoral unions, and each sectoral units will be dealing in various types of cooperatives specialized in particular area, such as housing cooperatives, agricultural cooperatives, credit unions, fishery societies, likewise. And under each sectoral union, there will be district unions. And under each district union, there will be primary societies. From primary societies, they will be the direct link with the members. So this is the overall concept or overall structure that we are prevailing in the most of the English or French dominated African countries. This was a vertical structure, and as mentioned earlier, regional unions provide service like processing and transport to affiliated primary society. This one, district, otherwise known as regional unions, and sectoral unions at the national level. These are the sectoral unions at national levels that provide bulk purchase of fertilizer. If it is relating to agriculture, it will be fertilizers and other sorts of requirement with regard to the nature of the say, cooperative unions. National Federation does not provide any sort of economic service. That is the apex unit that controls all the activities of the subsidiary, sectoral, regional and primary societies. So this is a general structure of a vertical integration system, and horizontal integration is almost similar to this concept. In horizontal integration, different types of cooperatives collaborate among themselves for the purpose of retaining financial and physical transactions in the moment. This is how what happens where agriculture cooperatives make use of transport cooperatives. Horizontal integration is still in primary stage of development in Africa. Just like a vertical integration system, horizontal integration will be for the time being, we will say this is a flowchart that moving from top to down. In a horizontal system, the plan will be spread across from left to right, where there will be a number of cooperatives. They will collaborate together, providing assistance to each other. Unlike a system where apex is the top level, followed by subsidiary, sectoral, and regional systems. And usually in almost all the African countries, this system is following. Horizontal system is in a primary stage and it is under development, and in future primary horizontal system may be implemented in different parts of the country. So that is the concept with regard to horizontal integration. Next one, governance and participation. Genuine cooperatives are democratic in nature and have high potential to move public to participate in national affairs. They can influence national policies towards the poor. The vertical integration enables them to participate in national decision making. So that is the system that operates in a general cooperative environment. It will be a democratic system, and it always encourages the public to participate in cooperative movements, especially in the national level as well as state level. They encourage them to participate in decision making activities, usually because it is a democratic system where everyone has freedom and power. So in general concept, in Africa, most of the cooperatives serve the state instead of members, because it is a democratic system where members are given more importance rather than the state-sponsored actions. So in Africa, most of the cooperatives serve the state instead of members. Incorporation of cooperative makes them the structures of operation instead of participation. That is why members are given importance rather than state, because state usually implement or impose all those actions, policies, plans that ultimately support state rather than members in common. That is the reason. That is why members are given more importance rather than state. Because in Ethiopia, peasant association forced the farmers into collective production against the needs of the people, because in that country the state forced the members of the society. In the agriculture society, there will be farmers. So they forced the farmers to produce those products that are not required or that are not the need of the people or the common people of that particular country, that are created for the requirement of the state government. The state government may produce and or use those products either for export or either for some moment to moment requirement, anything. The concept is, every government or every state sponsored movements should always consider the requirement of members and the common people. After fulfilling that, the government can go for anything else. But some countries, the situation is the opposite. So these are the situations that are prevailing in all various parts of the countries. We will discuss about the cooperative system and situations and environment with regard to the African perspectives in the future sessions. Just go through it. We will discuss about the further cases in the next one.